So good morning, friends. Welcome back to the course of software engineering. This video is brought to you by Newton's Group of Institutions, Macherla. This is Arvind Egireddy from the Department of Computer Science and Engineering. In our previous lectures, we have discussed a few basic issues in software engineering. And we pointed out a few important differences between the exploratory style of programming development and a software engineering approach. So please recollect from our discussions in the previous lectures that the exploratory style, which is also known as build and fix programming. And in the build and fix programming, the programmer, they typically start to write the programs immediately after he or she has formed an informal understanding of the requirements. And once this program writing is complete, he gets down to fix anything that does not meet the user's expectations. So here, usually a large number of code fixes are required even for small programs. And this pushes us to develop the development cost, and which is going to pull the quality of the program. And further, this approach usually turns out to be the recipe of the project failure when we are going to use to develop non-trivial programs which require team effort. So in contrast to build a fixed style, the software engineers, they approach software development through a well-defined and ordered set of activities. And these activities are graphically modeled or represented as a well-textually described and are vigorously called as software lifecycle models. Or software development lifecycle models, SDLC models, or software development process models. So here, several lifecycle models that have been proposed, but however, in this video, we confine our attention only to few important and commonly used ones. In this video, we first discuss the few basic concepts that are being associated with the lifecycle model, subsequently followed by the important activities that have been prescribed to be carried out on the classical waterfall model. So this will intend to provide an insight into activities that are carried out as part of every lifecycle model. So in fact, the classical waterfall model can be considered as the basic model, and all other lifecycle models are the extensions of this particular model to cast up the specific project situations. So after discussing this waterfall model, we will discuss few derivations of this model, and subsequently we will discuss the spiral model that generates various life cycle models. And finally, we discuss few recently proposed life cycle models that are categorized under the umbrella term agile model. Agile models are finding increasing acceptance among developers and researchers. That's the reason we will discuss about the agile model. Now let us see few basic concepts. So these are the few basic concepts what we need to concern while studying about the life cycle models. First one is software life cycle. So it is well known that all living organisms, they undergo a life cycle. For example, when a seed is planted, it germinates, grows into a full tree, and finally dies. So based on this concept of a biological life cycle, the term life cycle has been defined to imply the different stages over which the software evolves from the initial customer request for it to a fully developed software. And finally, to a stage where it is no longer useful to any user, and then it is discarded. So as we have already pointed out, the life cycle of every software starts with a request for it by one or more customers. And at this stage, the customers are usually not clear about all the features that would be needed. Neither can they be completely describe the identified features of the concrete terms, and can only unclearly describe what they need. And at this stage, where the customers feels a need for the software and they form a rough idea about the requirement features, and which we call it as an inception stage. So starting with the inception stage, a software evolves through a series of identifiable stages, which we call them as phases, on the account of the development activities carried out by the developers. And until it is fully developed and it is released to the customers. So once it has been released to the customers, we are going to install that particular software on the system where we are using and make it available for use. This implies that the start of operations phase will start, which we call it as an maintenance. So as the users use the software, not only they request for fixing the failures that might encounter, but they also continuously suggest several improvements and modifications to the software. Thus, the maintenance phase usually involves continually making changes to the software so that we can accommodate the bug fix and change the request for the user. So here, the operation phase is usually the longest of all the phases, and constitutes the usual life of a software. So here, finally, the software is retried. And when the user do not find it any longer useful due to some reasons, maybe changes such as business scenarios, or because of the availability of new softwares which are having improved features with good working capabilities, or maybe because of changed computation platforms, etc., etc. So this forms the essence of the life cycle of every software. So based on this description, we can define the software life cycle as the life cycle of the software, which represents the series of identifiable stages through which it evolves during its lifetime. And with this knowledge of a software life cycle, let us discuss the concepts of a software life cycle model, and let us explore why it is necessary to follow a life cycle model in professional software development environments. So another important concept what we need to understand is software development lifecycle model, SDLC. So in any systematic software development scenario, certain well-defined activities that need to be performed by the development team and possibly by the customers as well, for the software to evolve from one stage in its life cycle to the next stage. For example, for a software to evolve from the requirement specification stage to the design stage, here the developers, they need to elicit the requirements from the customers. They need to analyze those requirements, and then they have to formally document the requirements in the form of software requirement specification document. So a software development lifecycle model, which we also call as software lifecycle model or software development process model, which is going to describe the different activities that are needed to be carried out for the software to evolve in its life cycle phases. So throughout our discussion, we will be using the term software development lifecycle model or software development process model interchangeably. So this software development lifecycle model is one of the most important term what we will be discussing in our coming videos also. So a software development process which describes the life cycle activities more precisely and elaborately as compared to that of SDLC. So as a development process may not only describe the various activities that are to be carried out over the life cycle, but they also prescribe a specific methodologies to carry out these activities. And they also recommend the specific documentation and other artifacts that should be produced at the end of each phase. So here, in this sense, the term SDLC can be considered to be a more generic term as compared to the development process and several development processes that may be fit into the same SDLC. So here, and software development lifecycle is represented graphically by drawing various stages of the lifecycle and by showing the transitions among these phases. So here, this graphical model, which is usually accompanied by the textual description of various activities that need to be carried out during the phases, before these phases can be considered to be complete. So in simple words, we can define an SDLC like this. An SDLC which graphically depicts the different phases through which the software evolves, and it is usually accompanied by the textual description of different activities that need to be carried out during each phase. Now, let us see one more important concept, that is the difference between the process and methodology. So here, though the terms process and methodology are at a time used interchangeably, there is a huge difference between these two. First, the term process has a broader scope and which is going to address either all the activities that are being taking place during the software development or certain grained activities such as design process and testing process, etc., etc. So here, during a software process, they not only identify the specific activities that need to be carried out, but they also prescribe certain methodologies for carrying out each of these activities. So a software development process has much broader scope as compared to that of the software development methodology. Here, a process which usually describes all the activities which are being starting from the inspection to software to its maintenance and retirement stages. So it is also recommended that specific methodologies for carrying out each of these activities, a methodology which is a contrast, which describe the steps that are to be carried out, only a single or at best a few individual activities. Now, why we use or why we have to use this development process? What is the use of the development process? So here, the primary advantage of using a development process is it encourages the development of software in a systematic and disciplined manner, which is going to adhere a process which is especially important to the development of professional software that is being needed with a team effort. So when a software is developed by a team rather than by an individual programmer, so the use of life cycle model becomes indispensable for successful completion of the project. So software development organizations, they have realized the adherence to a suitable life cycle model that is going to help to produce good quality software and that is going to minimize the changes of time and cost overcomes. Suppose a single programmer is developing a small program. For example, a student may be trying to develop a code for his classroom assignment. So here the student may succeed even when he does not strictly follow the specific development process, or maybe he adopts a build and fix style of development. However, it is a different ball game when the professional software is being developed. So because here a team of programmers, they are going to develop the professional software. So now let us understand the difficulties that arise in if a team does not use any development process and the team members are given complete freedom to develop their assigned part of the software as per their own descriptions. So when a software is developed by a team, it is always necessary to have a precise understanding among the team members as to when to do what. And in the absence of such an understanding, if each member at that time would do whatever activity he feels like doing, then this would be an open invitation to the development chaos and project failure. So the use of suitable life cycle models is crucial to the successful completion of team-based development projects. So we need an SDLC model for developing a small program. So in this context, we need to distinguish between the programming in small and programming in large. So here, programming in small, which refers to the development of a small program by a single programmer, whereas programming in large, which is refers to a development of professional software through team effort. So while developing a software of the form programming with a large type could succeed even while the individual programmer, which uses a build and fix style of development. And use of suitable SDLC is essential for professional software development projects which involve a team effort to succeed. Now we have to understand why we have to document a development process. So what is the necessity of documenting the development process? So it is not enough for an organization to just have a well-defined development process, but the development process also need to be properly documented. So to understand the reason for this, let us consider that a development organization which does not document its development process. So here in this case, it's a developers develop only the informal understanding of the development process. So an informal understanding of the development process among the team members can create several problems during the development. So let us see some important problems that may crop up when a development process is not adequately documented. So these problems, there will be several problems. So maybe a document process model which ensures that every activity in the life cycle is actually defined. Also, whenever necessary, the methodologies for carrying out the respective activities, they have to be described. And without documentation, the activities and their order tend to be loosely defined, which may be leading to confusion and misinterpretation by different teams in the organization. So, for example, code reviews may be informally and inadequately be carried out since there is no document methodology as to how the code review should be done. And another difficulty is that for loosely defined activities, that developers, they tend to use their subjective judgments. So let us take this small example. So unless it is explicitly prescribed, the team members would subjectively decide as to whether to test the case or they have to just design after the requirement phase. And after the design phase, they have to do testing, or after the coding phase, they have to do the testing. And also, they would debate whether the test cases should be documented at all. And this rigorous with should be documented. So if it is not being documented, maybe they will be in a confused state whether the testing has to be done at each and every phase or not. And if at all, if they do testing also, they don't know what kind of testing they have to be done. It has to be done at that particular phase. Whether they have to do unit testing, where they have to do integration testing, where they have to do white box or black box testing. So all this should be properly documented. So an undocumented process which gives a clear indication to the members of the development team about the lack of seriousness on the part of the management of the organization about following that particular process. So therefore, an undocumented process which serves as an hint to the developers to loosely follow the process. So the symptoms of an undocumented process are easily visible so that the reviews are not carried out rigorously. So here a project team might often have to modify the standard process model for use in a particular specific project. So it is easier to modify a document process model when it is required to modify certain activities or phases of the life cycle. So a documented development process forms a common understanding of all the activities that need to be carried out among the software developers, and that will help them to develop the software in an systematic and disciplined manner. So a document development process model, besides preventing the misinterpretations that may occur when the developers that they are going to process it, or it may help to identify the inconsistencies, redundancies, and omissions in the development process. So nowadays, the good software development organization, they normally document their development process in the form of an booklet, so that they expect that the developers recruited fresh to their organizations to first master their software development process during a short induction training, and they are made to undergo into that particular project. Now, let us see what is phase entry and exit entry. So, what is phase entry criteria and exit criteria? What is phase process and exit process? So, for any good SDLC, besides clearly identifying the different phases in the life cycle, they should unambiguously define the entry and exit criteria for each phase. So here the phase entry criteria or exit criteria is usually expressed as a set of conditions that need to be satisfied for a phase to start or to complete. So here, let us take an example. So here the phase exit criteria for the software requirement specification phase can be the software requirement specification document, which is ready and has been reviewed internally and also been reviewed and approved by the customer. And only after these criteria are satisfied, the next phase can start. So, in the entry and exit criteria for various phases, if they are not well defined, then that would leave enough scope for ambiguity in starting and ending various phases, and that causes a lot of confusion among the developers. So, sometimes that might be prematurely stop the activities in a phase, and some other times they might continue working on the phase much after when the phase should have been over. So here, the decision regarding whether a phase is complete or not becomes subjective, and it becomes difficult for the project manager to accurately tell how much has the development progressed. So when the phase entry and the exit criteria are not well defined, the developers might close the activities of the phase much before they are actually complete, or give a false impression of a rigid progress. So here, in this case, it becomes very difficult for the project manager to determine the exact status of the development and track the progress of the project. And this usually going to lead to the problems that usually identified as 99% complete syndrome. And this syndrome that appears when there is when the software project managers has to define the way of assigning the progress of the project. So the optimistic team members, they feel that their work is 99% complete even when their work is far from completion. So making all projections made by the project manager about the project completion time, and that is highly inaccurate. So now let us see the classic waterfall model. So here a waterfall model and its derivatives are very extremely popular in the 1970s. And they are being heavily used across many development projects. So here the waterfall model is possibly the most obvious and intuitive way in which the software can be developed through team effort. So we can think of the waterfall model as a generic model that has been extended in many ways for certain specific software development situations to realize all other software lifecycle models. So for this reason only, after discussing the classical and iterative waterfall models, we will be discussing about the various extensions. So first let us see what exactly is this classical waterfall model. So here classical waterfall model is intuitively the most obvious way to develop the software. Of course, it is simple but idealistic. And in fact, it is hard to put this model into use in any non-trivial software development project. So you might wonder if this model is hard to use in practical development projects, then why to study it at all? Here, the reason is that the other lifecycle models, they can be thought of as being extensions of the classical waterfall model. Therefore, it makes sense to first understand what is classical waterfall model so that it will help us or in order to able to develop a proper understanding of other life cycle models. And besides, we shall see later in this text that this model, though not used for software development, which is implicitly used while documenting the software. So the classical waterfall model, which divides the life cycle model into set of phases as shown here. So it can easily be observed from here. We can see that we have feasibility study, requirement analysis and specification, design, coding and unit testing, integration and system testing, and maintenance testing. So from this figure, we can easily observe that this figure, that the diagrammatic representation of the classical waterfall model, which is going to resemble a multi-level waterfall. So here, this resemblance that justifies the name of the model, that is classical waterfall model. So here, the phases of the different classical waterfall model is the different, we can see is feasibility study, requirement and analysis and specification, designing, coding and unit testing, integration and system testing, and maintenance. So here, the phases start from the feasibility study to the integration testing and the system testing phase, which we also call as the development phase. So the phases starting from feasibility study to the integration and system testing phases, which we call them as a development phase. So a software is developed during the development phase, and the completion of the development phase, the software is delivered to the customer. So after the delivery of the software, the customers, they start to use the software, signaling the commencement of the operation phase. So here, as the customers, they start to use the software changes wherever and whenever necessary. Based on their feedbacks, we have to fix the bugs and sometimes maybe future extensions, which causes the maintenance works to be undertaken. So therefore, the last phase, which is known as maintenance phase of the life cycle. So here, an activity that spans all the phases of the software development is project management, that is maintenance. So here, since it spans the entire project during, no specific phase is named after it. So here, the project management nevertheless is an important activity in the life cycle, and which deals with the managing of the software development and maintenance activities. So here in a waterfall model, different life cycle phases that typically require relatively different amount of effort to be put into the put by the development team. So the relative amount of effort that is being spent on different phases of a typical software, we can see in this particular figure. So if you can clearly observe the figure, among all the life cycle phases, the maintenance phase, which normally requires the maximum effort. So on the average, about 60% of the total effort put in the development team is in the entire life cycle is spent on maintenance activities only. Okay, so here relative effort distributed among the different phases of the typical product. So however, among the development phase, the integration and system testing phase, which requires the maximum effort in a typical development project. So now let us briefly describe the different activities that are carried out in different phases of a classical waterfall model. First one is feasibility study. So here the main focus of the feasibility study stage is to determine whether it would be financially and technically feasible to develop the software. So here the feasibility study involves carried out several activities such as collection of the basic information relating to the software, such as different data items that would be input to the system, the processing required to carry out these data, the output data that is required to produced by the system, as well as various constraints to be developed. So these collected data are analyzed to perform the following things, following activities, we can say. First one is development of an overall understanding of the problem. So here it is necessary to first develop an overall understanding of what the customer requires to be developed. So here for this, only the important requirements of the customers that need to be understood, and the details of the various requirements such as screen layouts required in the graphical user interface, specific formulas or algorithms required for producing the required results, and the database schemas to be used or to be collected. Next, we have to formulate the various possible strategies for solving the problem. So in this activity, various possible high-level solution schemas to the problem are determined. For example, solution in a client-server framework and a standalone application framework may be explored. Next, the evolution of different solution strategies need to be identified. So the different identified solution schemas, they are analyzed to evaluate their benefits and shortcomings, such as the evaluations which are often required for making an approximate estimates of the resource required, cost of development, and a development item that is being required. So here, these different solutions, they are compared based on the estimations that have been worked out. So once the best solution is identified, then all the activities in the later phases are carried out as per the solution that is being given. So, and at this stage, it may also be determined that none of the solutions is feasible due to maybe because of high cost or resource constraints or some other different technical reasons. So then what we have to do is, this scenario would of course require the project to be abandoned. And we can summarize the outcomes of the feasibility study phase by nothing that other than deciding whether to take up the project or not. And at this stage, a very high level decision regarding the solution strategy is being defined. So here, the feasibility study is very crucial stage in the software. And the second phase, requirement and analysis, requirements, analysis and specification. So here the aim of the requirement analysis and specification phase is to understand the exact requirements of the customer and the documents there, and we have to document them properly. So this phase, which consists of two distinct activities, namely requirement gathering and analysis and requirement specifications. So in this we will give an overview of both these two different activities, that is requirement gathering and analysis and requirement specification. So here, requirement gathering analysis. So the goal of the requirement gathering activities is to collect the relevant information regarding the software to be developed from the customer with a view to clearly understand the requirements. And for this, the first requirements are gathered from the customer and then the gathered requirements are analyzed. So here, the goal of the requirements analysis activity is to prepare out the incompleteness and inconsistencies in gathering these requirements. Okay, so note that an inconsistent requirement is one in which some part of the requirements that contradicts with some other parts. And on the other hand, an incomplete requirement is one in which some part of the actual requirements have been omitted. Now coming to the requirements specification. Requirement specification. So after the requirements are being gathered and analyzed, the activities are complete. So the identified requirements need to be documented. And this is called software requirement specification, SRS document. So here the SRS document is written using an end user terminology. And this makes the SRS document understandable to the customer. So therefore, to understand the SRS document, which is an important issue. And these SRS documents then normally serve as a contract between the development team and the customer. And further, any dispute between the customer and the developer that can be settled and been examined by these SRS documents. So here, the SRS document is therefore an important document which must be thoroughly understood by the development team and that need to be reviewed jointly with the customer. So here, the SRS documents not only forms the basis for carrying out all the development activities, but several documents such as user manuals, system test plans, etc. are prepared directly based on it. Then coming to the third phase, that is the design phase. So sometimes we call this the designing phase as implementation phase also. So here the goal of the design phase is to transform the requirements which are specific to the SRS documents into the structure which is suitable for implementation in some programming language. So here the technical term during the design phase of software architecture is derived from the SRS documents. So here there are two distinct different design approaches that are been popularly being used at present. One is the procedural and object oriented design approaches. So procedural approach and object oriented approach. So let us see what is an procedural oriented approach. So the traditional design approach, which is in use in many software development projects at the present time, is this procedural design approach. So this traditional design technique is based on the data flow oriented design approach. And it consists of two important activities. First, structured analysis of the requirement specification that is carried out, where the detailed structure of the problem is examined. And this is followed by structured design steps, where the results of the structured analysis are transformed into software design. So during structured analysis, the functional requirements specified in the SRS documents are decomposed into sub-functions. And the data flow among these functions is analyzed and represented diagrammatically in the form of DFDs. So here, structured design is undertaken once the structured analysis activity is complete. And this structured design consists of two main activities. We call these as architectural design, also called as high level design, and detailed design, which is called as a low level design. So high level design, which is going to involve decomposing the system into modules and representing the interfaces and the innovation relationships among the modules. So a high level software design is sometimes which is referred to as a software architecture. So during the detailed design activities, internals of these individual modules, such as the data structures and algorithms of the modules, are designed and documented. Now coming to object-oriented design approach. So in this technique, various objects that occur in the problem domain and the solution domain are first identified, and the different relationships that exist among these objects are identified. So here the object structure is further refined to obtain the detailed design. So the OOAD approach is credited to have several benefits, such as lower development time and effort, better maintainability of the software, and it also lower the development time also, reduces the time also. Now coming to the next phase, that is coding and unit testing. So here the purpose of coding and unit testing phase is to translate a software design into source code and to ensure that individually each function is working correctly. So here the coding phase is also sometimes called as an implementation phase, since the design is implemented into a workable solution in this particular phase. So each component of the design is implemented as a program module, and the end product of this phase is as a set of program modules that have been individually unit tested. So the main objective here for the reason behind the unit testing is to determine the correct working of the individual module. So here this specific activity is carried out during the unit testing, which includes design test cases, testing, debugging to fix the problems, and management of test cases. Now coming to integration and system testing, integration of different modules is undertaken soon after they have been coded and unit tested. So during the integration and system testing phase, the different modules are integrated in a planned manner, and various modules making up this particular software are almost never integrated in one shot. So can anyone guess the reason for this? Because integration of various modules are normally carried out incrementally over a number of steps. And during each integration step, previously planned modules are added to the partially integrated system, and the resultant system is tested. And finally, after all the modules have been successfully integrated and tested, the full working system is obtained. And the system testing is carried out on this fully working system. So whether as integration testing is carried out to verify that the interfaces among the different units are working satisfactorily. So on the other hand, the goal of the system testing is to ensure that the developed system conforms to the requirements that have been laid out on the SRS documents. So here, system testing they usually consists of three different kinds of testing activities. Testing, acceptance of testing. Testing. Here, testing is the system testing performed by the development team. Again, testing is the system testing that is being performed by a friendly set of customers. And then acceptance testing, after the software has been delivered, the customers perform system testing to determine whether to accept that delivered software or to reject it. Now, coming to the last phase, that is maintenance phase. Here, so the total effort spent on maintenance of the typical software during its operation is much more than the required for developing the software itself that we have seen in our previous slides. So many studies that carried out the past, they confirm that this and indicate the ratio of the relative effort of developing a typical software product and the total effort spent on maintenance is roughly 40:60. So in our previous slide that we have seen this particular thing. So for maintenance, most of the development, they are spending 60% of the time. So remaining all the other phases, they are spending 40%. Of course, in that also, testing is having the more time. So here maintenance is required in the following three types of situations. One is corrective maintenance, perfective maintenance, and adaptive maintenance. So what is corrective maintenance? So this type of maintenance is carried out to correct the errors that were not discovered during the product development phase. And coming to the perfective maintenance, this type of maintenance is to be carried out to improve the performance of the system or to enhance the functionalities of the system based on the customer's request. And coming to the adaptive maintenance, which is usually required for porting the software to work in a new environment. For example, porting may be required to get the software to work on a new computer platform or with a new operating system. So now let us once again revise what are the shortcomings of this classical waterfall model. So here the classical waterfall model is a very simple and intuitive model. Of course, it suffers from several shortcomings. So let us see some of the important shortcomings of the classical waterfall model. The first one is no feedback path. That is, in classical waterfall model, the evolution of the software from one phase to the next is analogous to the waterfall. So just as water in a waterfall, after having flowed down, cannot flow back. So once a phase is complete, the activity is carried out in it. And any artifact produced in these phases are considered to be final and closed for any rework. So this requires that all the activities during a phase are faultlessly carried out. So the classical waterfall model is idealistic in the same sense that assumes that no error is ever committed by the developer during any of the life cycle phases, and therefore which incorporates no mechanism for error correction. And the second shortcoming of this classical waterfall model is difficult to accommodate changes request. So this model assumes that all the customer requirements can be completely and correctly defined at the beginning of the project itself. So there is much emphasis on creating an unambiguous and complete set of requirements. So here it is very hard to achieve this even in ideal project scenarios, because the customer requirements usually keep on changing with the time. But in this model, it becomes difficult to accommodate any requirement changes or change requests that are being made by the customer after the requirement specification phase is complete. And this often becomes a source of customer disconnectiveness. And the other drawback is inefficient error correction. So this model defers integration of code and testing task until it is very late when the problem are harder to resolve. And the third drawback is no overlapping of phases. So this model recommends that the phases being carried out sequentially, so no phase can start, a new phase can be started only after the previous one completes. So, however, it is rarely possible to adhere to this recommendation. And this leads to a large number of team members to be idle for extended periods. And the other drawback is the classical waterfall model. Is it useful at all? As we have already pointed out at the beginning itself, that this is very hard to use the classical waterfall model in the real-time projects. So I hope you followed this particular video. Please do follow for knowing about the other models. So the next topic will be continuing is about the iterative waterfall model. So we will see what is iterative model waterfall model. So that's all for now. If you like this particular video, please subscribe to my channel and please press the bell icon for the latest notifications. Thank you.